Here to dive into industry trends with leading ETF experts, this is ETF Spotlight with Nina Mishra.
Hello and welcome to ETF Spotlight. I'm your host, Nina Mishra. My guest today is Matt Bartolini, head of Spider America's research at State Street Global Advisors. We are talking about the midterm elections, what they could mean for some key policies, and how investors could prepare their portfolios for midterms. Matt, welcome back. Great to have you on the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So I wanted to start with your thoughts on the recent market action, and stocks have rallied nicely this month. The S&P 500 index is up almost 8% in October, and that's thanks mainly to some better than expected earnings and also hopes for a Fed pivot. Now stocks are down today. We are talking on Wednesday, October the 26th, for the purpose of reference. They are down today following disappointing earnings reports by Google and Microsoft, which are two of the most influential stocks in the major indexes. So tell us about your thoughts on the recent market rally. Should investors chase or fade this rally?
So I think the rally is happening at an interesting time because we have had earnings reports come out and be better than expected, but those expectations leading up until earnings season had been ratcheted down. Nevertheless, the positive results from earnings has been supportive from a market's perspective. Also, entering the month of October, the markets were decidedly oversold when you look at it from a technical perspective and hit, you know, some pretty key barriers of that 3,500 level on the S&P 500. So the market was sort of seemingly primed for a little bit of a rally and a bounce. What I find a little bit more interesting about this rally, as opposed to the one, say, in over the summer months, is that this is being led by some of the more higher quality names, as well as some of the ones that have more sort of durability within their balance sheets and are not a high beta, unprofitable, very heavily shorted type of stocks that were at the forefront of the sort of June-July rally as well. So I think there's a little bit more legs to this rally. You know, we're coming up to some key technical indicators, whether it be the 50-day or 100-day moving average. So it'd be interesting to see if the market can rally past those. And again, I think the one of the big parts we'll find out in November, November 2nd, when the Fed meets again, if they do a jumbo rate hike again of 75 basis points or 50 basis points, because one of the main drivers of market sentiment has been this aggressive Fed policy. And so we're going to get an update on that. But as of right now, the healthy fundamentals from earnings season were the better than expected has been supportive for more positive market returns.
So let's talk about midterm elections now, which are now less than 2 weeks away. And one of the biggest questions that investors have now is whether these midterms are going to trigger a stock market rally. And that is because stocks have generally produced positive returns in the year following midterm elections. So the general perception is that stocks rise after midterm elections. So according to the Wall Street Journal, the S&P 500 has risen in the 1 year period following every midterm election since 1942. And on average, the index has gained about 15% in the 1 year post midterm period. But according to your research, this time could be different. Tell us why.
Yeah, so I think it's going to be a bit different and for a couple of reasons. One is we're having a significantly more aggressive Federal Reserve than we've really ever had before. If the Fed does fall through on the rate hike expectations the market has put out there, which essentially equates to, at the end of December, a Fed funds rate around 425 basis points, that would be 425 basis points of a net change in the Fed funds rate, which would be the most aggressive the Fed has ever been, irrespective of midterms, but of course also within a midterm election. Prior aggressiveness was witnessed back in the late 1970s, 1978. So you have an aggressive monetary policy. I think there's also the key factor here is while you have that aggressive monetary policy, there's less flexibility for supportive fiscal policy as well. So typically what happens after a midterm election, it's generally been a referendum on the current administration. And what happens is then policies are put forth to try to curry favor ahead of the general election to continue and maintain that place in power. And so we usually have, you know, very accommodative fiscal policy and pro-growth measures. We're at a time period now where there's less flexibility for those fiscal policy measures because of the elevated level of inflation. So I wouldn't expect to see big fiscal packages. So you have these sort of two factors at play of you know, really restrictive monetary policy and less flexibility in fiscal policy, all because of the environment we've been in for the better part of 18 months or so. So I think following the midterm elections, I'm not saying there will be negative returns, but I think that you'll likely see returns that are below that historical average rate of return that we typically see after midterms. I mean, I think the statistic is dating back to 1962, the average return on 12-month return on the S&P 500 post-midterms is 16.3%. So I think you can expect something below that, sort of below that average rate of return. And I think one of the most sort of strongest corollaries of the type of environment we are in is that 1978 timeframe. I think it's fair comparable because back then there was high inflation, there was weak economic growth that led to a very shallow and brief recession in 1980. The Fed was hiking rates quite significantly. And what happened is that there were positive returns, but those returns were well below the historical average that you typically see at midterms. So I think this is going to be a different time period than the average would indicate, just because of that lack of flexibility from a fiscal perspective and the significant aggressiveness from a monetary perspective.
So according to recent polls, a divided Congress is the most likely outcome, with the Democrats retaining the Senate and Republicans taking control of the House of Representatives. And we know that how accurate or inaccurate these polls are generally. But investors should know how some of the key policies could be impacted on whether the Democrats or Republicans control Congress. So let's discuss some of the important policies. Let's start with the energy policy, because these midterms are likely to determine the future of the Biden administration's energy and climate agenda. And Republicans in general favor more support for domestic oil and gas industry, and President Biden wants to support cleaner and alternative sources of energy. So let's talk about the energy policies, how they could be impacted, and then we can discuss some of the important ETFs too that investors could look at.
Yeah, so I think energy policy is very bifurcated. There's very diametrically opposed views on this. You know, when talking to clients around midterm election portfolio alterations or implementation ideas, it is sort of positioning for the surprise, because right now the broader consensus is for that split Congress where the Democrats retained control of the Senate and Republicans are able to flip the House and you have a divided Congress, which, you know, again, going back to the broader market commentary perspective, historically has been one of the strongest returning type of composition within within Washington. When you have, you know, a Democratic president and a split Congress, the average rate of return from that perspective is 13.6%, and that's the second most behind a Republican senator, Democratic House, and Republican president. Yeah, and some of these are, you know, sample size bias, all in regards. But that is the consensus, but there's still, you know, election surprises. We witnessed these in more recent history, and some of the polls, particularly on the Senate side, the Democrats' lead is starting to really tighten up. And right now, there's only roughly about a 60% chance of them taking it down from 70% just about a month ago. So, you know, positioning for those surprises can help. And I think one of the areas where there's, again, those diametrically opposed views is within energy. I think if the Democrats are able to surprise, retain seats in the House, and continue to have ownership and control of the Senate, you are likely to see a continuation of Biden's agenda, which would increase climate investments, and you would continue to see, you know, whether it be legislation for clean energy refundable tax credits, investment in clean energy and subsidies, as well as just broad-based legislation to phase out fossil fuels. So that would really benefit those stocks that are focused on clean energy investments, so clean energy industries like power generation, wind, solar, and geothermals. Conversely, if the Republicans are able to gain control of both houses, there would be a much more stronger support for the legacy energy sector. And I think you'll see a curtailment of those additional climate investments that have been discussed within the Biden administration. So that would mean focusing on your traditional oil and gas production and services firms. And of course, you know, we have exposures that align to sort of all of these views.
So let's talk about some of the ETFs that investors could look at. And one of the ETFs is your clean power ETF. It is the SPDR S&P Kensho Clean Power ETF. Ticker symbol is CNRG. And as far as traditional energy ETFs are concerned, two of ETFs from your suite are very popular, XLE and XOP. Tell us a bit about these three ETFs.
Yeah, so CNRG, the clean power ETF, that's going to focus on firms really innovating within those clean power industries like wind, solar, and geothermals. And that's going to be a very concentrated basket of around 40 or so stocks, really give you that sort of specific and pure industry exposure to firms on that leading edge of clean energy. Conversely, if we look at, you know, the two energy ETFs, XLE, that's your broad market cap weighted energy sector, you know, S&P 500 ETF, that's going to give you that, you know, broad-based sector exposure. Something like XOP is a modified equal weighted exposure that covers both large, mid, and small firms within the oil and gas production. And what we historically have seen, because you're now diving deeper into the market cap segmentation space, adding in more mid and small cap firms where they perhaps they're not as diversified oil companies like your large mega caps like Exxon and Chevron, you know, they are going to be much more sensitive to the spot price of oil. And so they typically have a higher beta exposure to the spot price of oil. So if there's going to be more support for the energy sector and just more broadly, even, you know, again, irrespective of elections, the energy complex is, you know, been one of the strongest performers this year. And XOP has been able to capture some of that because of that higher beta.
Excellent. So let's talk about defense spending now. And we know that increasing defense spending is one of the very few areas that the two parties agree on. And in fact, we have seen that defense stocks, aerospace and defense stocks, have done pretty well lately, thanks mainly to rising geopolitical tensions, because we know that the Russia-Ukraine war is unlikely to end soon. North Korean saber rattling has been on the rise, and China-Taiwan tensions have also flared up since President Xi secured a third term in office. So do you expect an increase in defense spending after the midterms?
Yeah, so in sort of, you know, thinking about the market environment where you're positioning for the surprises, defense is one area where you may be positioning for broad-based consensus and support. Defense, I think, is one of those bipartisan issues that can be agreed upon irrespective of who is the controlling party. And we saw this even in July when 180 Democrats and 149 Republicans in the House of Representatives joined forces to approve $37 billion in defense spending, $37 billion more in defense spending than President Biden's $69 billion request for the fiscal year of 2023. So there is support there. And there's support because of what's going on from a geopolitical perspective. Like you mentioned, the Russia-Ukraine war, you know, we had the Nord Stream pipeline leak. You have rising tensions around the Taiwan Strait. And you are likely to see continued focus and support for additional defense spending. I think irrespective of the election outcomes, whether it is all Democrat or all Republican or a split Congress, you can see firms that are in the aerospace and defense industry, as well as those that are in the more innovative spaces that are maybe purely focused on cyber, drones, border protection, things on those lines, could potentially see a positive turn in sentiment based on the election outcomes.
So let's talk about the implementation ideas and the two ETFs that you mentioned in your note, the SPDR S&P Aerospace and Defense ETF, ticker symbol XAR, and the SPDR S&P Kensho Future Security ETF, ticker symbol FIGHT, F-I-T. Both these ETFs are equal weighted ETFs. Tell us about the differences between these two ETFs.
Yeah, so XAR is going to focus purely on the traditional GICS-based aerospace and defense industry. So it's only going to own firms that are identified as being aerospace and defense per the GICS classification schema, you know, as put forth by S&P and MSCI. The SPDR S&P Kensho Future Security ETF FIGHT, it breaks beyond those GICS classification frameworks and looks at, you know, uses artificial intelligence to look at what companies are saying in their regulatory filings about how they may be innovating along certain key dimensions, whether it be, you know, cybersecurity, drones, border protection, and other areas of defense. So that one is going to have more of an innovation feel to it because it is going to look at those firms and how they're describing their material operations as it relates to sort of forward-looking prospects for future security.
Let's talk about the tax policy now. And there are some major differences between the two parties as far as taxes are concerned. Democrats favor tax increases on large corporations and also on high-income individuals. And on the other hand, if Republicans gain control of the House, they want to make the so-called Trump tax cuts permanent. So talk to us about the impact on the tax policy, and then we can discuss the ETFs.
Yeah, so I think the tax policy here is rather straightforward, and it sort of centers on the Democrats take control of both around the expansion of perhaps the buyback tax. And if there's an expansion of the buyback tax, that may result in firms putting a higher priority on dividends and therefore, you know, lead to a higher focus on companies that are paying payout dividends. So we like the dividend payers as a result of that, because I think, you know, people would likely favor those as a means of a return of value to shareholders. On the other side, you know, there's going to be little wiggle room that the Republicans can have in order to make drastic changes to tax policy. But under the Republicans, it'll be more likely that those tax breaks do get extended, or some of the provisions in the Inflation Reduction Act can get reversed. As a result, you know, you're also going to see some restraint towards a tax increase on multinational income or the OECD global tax. So under a Republican framework, firms that generate a large amount of foreign sources of revenue, like technology, semiconductors, those could be favored over domestic low tax sectors like real estate. So for this, it's more within tax policy, it's more about a relative play. So relatively speaking, high dividend paying equities should potentially do better than high buyback equities under the Democrat scenario. And in a Republican scenario, high foreign revenue industries like semiconductors should do better as opposed to low tax sectors like a real estate.
So let's talk about some of the implementation ideas. You mentioned dividends may be in focus if Democrats retain control of the Congress, and the two ETFs that you have mentioned in your note, the Spider Dow Jones REIT ETF, ticker symbol RWR, and the Spider Portfolio S&P 500 High Dividend ETF, ticker symbol SPYD. This has been quite popular this year because investors love high dividend payers this year. So tell us about both these ETFs.
So SPYD, very simple. It's the 80 highest paying for highest dividend paying firms in the S&P 500, then equally weighted. For RWR, it's the subcomponent of the REIT industry of the U.S. equity market. So those are pretty straightforward type of exposures. And I think, you know, we've obviously seen SPYD quite used heavily this year, just given that it's going to be more value-oriented than anything else. It also pays that high dividend, which I think has been attractive in a downward trending market. And that value exposure has been rewarded that's been a strong factor this year. On the Republican side, you know, the implementation idea is centered around, you know, semiconductor ETFs like XSD, our S&P semiconductor ETF. Again, that one's purely focused from an industry perspective, any firm within that semiconductor industry. And then we have another ETF, XNTK. It is our sort of a broader-based technology ETF that is also equally weighted. And that gives you some exposure into communication services, consumer discretionary, as well as technology stocks, you know, in that sort of high-tech type flavor.
So let's talk about infrastructure programs now. And there's generally bipartisan support for increasing spending on infrastructure. So tell us how midterms will impact these infrastructure programs and spending on infrastructure and ETFs that investors could consider.
Yeah, so infrastructure is another one of those areas where there could be some added bipartisan support. So irrespective of the outcome, there could be some work that's done across the aisle to support infrastructure build-outs and infrastructure packages. We saw this already in just November of 2021 when the bipartisan infrastructure law was signed, providing $550 billion of new federal investments over 5 years. So it's a pretty strong area of bipartisan support. I do think some of the usage of those funds or the deployment of them could be different under different scenarios. I think under the Democrat area of control, I think there would be significant focus on securing broadband and water funding. That's something that was already a key component within that bipartisan infrastructure law from the Democrat side. So I think the Democrats would likely focus more on that sustainable, intelligent infrastructure, whereas Republicans would likely place a greater emphasis on the traditional sense of infrastructure, the roads, bridges, and ports. And again, this is all just based on some of the rhetoric and earlier designs of that bipartisan infrastructure law. So while there is support, bipartisan support, the implementation of that support can differ under the different scenarios.
Now, switching gears a little bit, I wanted to talk about ETF fund flows as well, because I know that you track fund flows very closely. So this year has been very challenging for almost all asset classes, but ETFs have had impressive cash gathering. So tell us about some of the notable trends that you have seen recently in terms of fund flows.
So on an annual basis, ETFs are highly likely to surpass $500 billion once again for the third consecutive year in a row. Right now, year-to-date flows are at $482 billion, and you know, we still have 2 full months left. October, there's been a significant rebound in overall flows. There's been $63 billion of flows. It's one of the highest amounts we've seen all year, pretty much outside of the first 3 months of the year, because there has been a lot of trepidation. There has been a lot of lack of conviction of deploying capital. So fund flows, while hitting or likely to hit that $500 billion mark, and honestly, probably be well over the $510 billion from 2020, which is the second all time. So this will probably be the second most ever. Some of that support has come from the sort of traditional secular growth of ETFs as strategic asset allocation tools and low-cost exposures that offer tax efficiency. Because what you're seeing from the mutual fund space is significant negative returns, as all asset classes are down. But also active managers, you know, roughly 70% of active managers as a group within the mutual fund space have underperformed their benchmarks. There's underperformance. And as we know, there's historically a high propensity of active managers in the mutual fund space that do end up paying capital gains. So a lot of mutual fund investors are likely to be hit with sort of the three bad outcomes, you know, negative returns, negative relative returns to a benchmark, and a tax bill, all wrapped up in a high fee type strategy. So what we have seen this year is a lot of tax loss harvesting out of those type of strategies, then the acceleration of the great migration from mutual funds to ETFs. And beneath the surface, the areas that have gained significant flows this year have been those dividend equity exposures. Dividend equity exposures have taken in, you know, $59 billion this year. That's a record amount. And they've gone on a 24 consecutive month streak of inflows. So it's been a significant asset gatherer, as have been, more in a tactical sense, your ultra short and short-term government bond exposures, about $113 billion. So investors are expressing some tactical views here within the sort of subcomponents of ETFs, in addition to that sort of secular growth we see from low-cost strategic asset allocation vehicles.
Excellent stuff. That's all we have time for today. Matt, always a pleasure to have you on this show. Thanks always for sharing your insights and for joining us today.
Thank you.
So that was Matt Bartolini of State Street Global Advisors. Thanks for listening. If you like our show, please leave us a rating on iTunes or wherever you get your podcast. And also make sure to subscribe so that you do not miss any episode. If you have any comments, questions, or suggestions, please email podcast@zacks.com.
This material is being provided for informational purposes only, and nothing herein constitutes investment, legal, accounting, or tax advice, or a recommendation to buy, sell, or hold a security. Do not act or rely upon the information and advice given in this podcast without seeking the services of competent and professional legal, tax, or accounting counsel. Publication and distribution of this podcast is not intended to create, and the information contained herein does not constitute, an attorney-client relationship. No recommendation or advice is being given as to whether any investment or strategy is suitable for a particular investor. It should not be assumed that any investments in securities, companies, sectors, or markets identified and described were or will be profitable. All information is current as of the date herein and is subject to change without notice. Any views or opinions expressed may not reflect those of Zacks Investment Research as a whole.